Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our Shiloh International Missions Worship Service. Let's begin our worship with the word of prayer, and then we'll go into our praise. Let's lift up our prayer to God. Gracious Heavenly Father, we praise you and we thank you, Lord, for gathering us together again this afternoon. We pray, Lord God, that as your saints gather together now for worship, we pray, Lord God, that your spirit would be upon the sanctuary and upon your people. We pray, Lord God, that through our praise this afternoon, may you receive all the glory, honor, and praise. That, Father, may nothing be taken for ourselves, but everything that we do here and now may be turned over to you as glory to you. We ask, Lord God, that you'd be upon all the members of Shiloh as they gather here now. We pray, Lord God, that they would open up their hearts for worship. Would you bestow your grace upon us now? We thank you, Father, for blessing us and for being with us, and we pray all of this in your Son, Jesus Christ's name, with thanksgiving. Amen. We'll sing All the Earth together.
Yeah. Yeah.
from the north,
from the north,
north,
south,
south,
east,
east to the west.
There's gonna be a revival. From the north,
north,
south,
south,
east, east to the west, there's gonna be a revival in this land.
There's gonna be a revival.
There's gonna be a revival.
Song is going to be a song called Through It All. And if I could share anything with you guys, for the past week, our church has gone through a lot of new experiences and a lot of new things. And especially was evident through the pastors that came last week for 6 days. And through that experience, I learned a lot of things. I think a lot of people involved that learned a lot of things, that the word of redemptive history is not stopping here, but it's going abroad to all the nations. And to be able to see proof of that was an amazing thing to see. And so if we can come to an understanding here in Shiloh that the word of redemptive history is going to move through this ministry, I would desire for us to all come together to not only pray for it, but to pray that the preachers that are preaching the words of redemptive history can take it to the far reaches of the world. That our senior pastors dream that the nations will come running and dancing to Pyongyang Greater Church, that it would come true to Shiloh International Missions as well. I'd like to give a couple prayer topics before we sing our last song. We'll go into a time of prayer. Let's pray first and foremost for the nation of Korea and for the protection that God will give to this nation. Secondly, let's pray for Pyongyang Greater Church and for all of the various ministries that are proclaiming the words of redemptive history, that through our senior pastor and through all the pastors and evangelists, that this word would be confirmed not only here, but also abroad. Last but not least, all of our individual prayer requests, whatever they may be, whether you guys are tired, sick, whether your family issues, whatever they may be, lay them all through at the feet of Jesus Christ, that through it all, that he's going to give us his grace that will be sufficient for us. So we'll sing Through It All, and we'll go into a time of prayer.
Through it all.
I'll sing to you, Lord.
I'll sing to you, Lord. A hymn of love for your faithfulness to me. I'm carried in everlasting arms. You'll never let me go.
I'll sing to you. I'll sing to you. Together, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Let's all raise our hands together and sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Go to time of prayer. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you.
and that we may worship you in spirit and in truth, so that this worship service may be lifted up as an offering to you. We give all honor, glory, and thanks to your wondrous name. Father God, tomorrow is a special day for this nation. It is a memorial day where we commemorate the service and the sacrifice of the many brave men and women who gave their lives defending their country. I pray, Father God, that your spirit will be with us so that we will know that although you use soldiers, although you use technology, although you use physical weapons to physically protect this country, we know, Father God, that the true protection is only by relying upon your mighty arms, only by relying on your word and your spirit, Father God, can we be protected against any darkness and any evil and any force that works to go against your work of redemptive history. I, Father God, that by studying your word and by proclaiming the light of redemptive history itself, that we also will be able to defend not just our physical nation, but the spiritual nation, which is the kingdom of heaven that we are to inherit. Father God, please bless all the men and women serving their nations, whether they are serving in Korea, in America, or anywhere in the world. Let your hand of protection and mercy be upon them. Let your hand of diligence, let your hand of righteousness be their strong foundation, so that everything they do so that they will be able to accomplish your providence and your work, which you have established since before time. Father God, we now lift up to you this service. I pray, Father, that as our blessed evangelist Joanna Pace speaks, that the words that she proclaims will be the words of life that we receive, so that the rivers of life will flow out of our hearts. As it does so, Father God, let these living waters be able to flow out into all the nations, so that any nation that is thirsty, any nation that is sick, their thirst will be quenched and their illness is healed by the power of your word. In the past week, Father, we bore incredible witness into the work of redemptive history that is taking place here in Seoul, Korea, at Pyongyang Jail Church. We saw people from many nations and tongues come here to study your word. But Father God, as much as they have been blessed, we more so have been blessed to see the coming of the dream of the man of God, senior pastor, that nations will come singing and dancing to Pyongyang Jail Church to learn the word of redemptive history. Although we are so weak and incapable of going out into the world itself, by your grace, you have allowed these representatives from all the nations to come here to learn the word. And Father God, you have ignited in their heart the fire and the passion to spread your word of redemptive history into their own nations. Father God, this has been just a small seed that has been planted. I pray that the seed of redemptive history will grow into a mighty tree like that of the mustard tree. And in doing so, all the nations will be able to take shelter within the branches of your word of redemptive history. We also, Father God, lift up to you Shiloh Choir. As they sing their praises, may they cast away any darkness that is upon us, and may they herald the proclaiming of your word, so that when we receive it, the doors of grace will be opened. Let our hearts, Father God, be able to receive your word and truly be blessed by it. And in doing so, let them apply to our lives so that we may be a living testimony, living witnesses as to what your word of redemption can accomplish. Father God, we pray for all the congregation here and everyone watching around the world through the broadcast that they will be truly blessed by this worship service that we lift up unto you. Let it be a pleasing offering, Father God, as a sweet aroma. And in doing so, please open the gates of heaven so that we will truly be able to receive your blessings. The beginning and the end, Father God, we give unto you. And with thankful hearts we pray in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. The bread of life today is read from Matthew chapter 1, verses 6 through 11. Once again, that is Matthew chapter 1, verses 6 through 11. Jesse was the father of David the king. David was the father of Solomon by Bathsheba, who had been the wife of Uriah. Solomon was the father of Rehoboam, Rehoboam the father of Abijah, and Abijah the father of Asa. Asa was the father of Jehoshaphat, Jehoshaphat the father of Joram, and Joram the father of Uzziah. Uzziah was the father of Jotham, Jotham the father of Ahaz, and Ahaz the father of Hezekiah. Hezekiah was the father of Manasseh, Manasseh the father of Amon, and Amon the father of Josiah. Josiah became the father of Jeconiah and his brothers at the time of the deportation to Babylon. And this is the word of God. We will now hear the choral anthem from Shiloh Choir.
We can share in God's redeeming. Hello, Shiloh. It's so good to see you all. It's been so while, and thank you so much for such gracious choral anthem. Okay. So today, I would like to speak about who we are, right? New pen. So in order for us to really understand who we are, we're going to find out our identity from the genealogy of Jesus Christ. So these are the kings. Omitted from the second period of Jesus's genealogy. But before we begin, I would like to take you all the way to the end of the days, the last days. If you see the Bible, God clearly says in the last days, he will finish or consummate his work of redemption through the church. Okay. It's through the church. So you see how important it is what kind of church you attend in the last days is very, very important. Because in the end time, God will consummate, finish his work through the church. And this we see in Revelation, the book which tells us all about the end time. In Revelation, it opens with God's letter written out to seven churches, okay? And that is found in Revelation chapter 2 and Revelation chapter 3. So God writes to all the seven churches, and if you see in Revelation chapter 1, verse 20, God says these churches are his lampstand. And God will be found amidst of his seven lampstands. From here, we can see in the last days, he will be working through the church. And here, every time after he finished writing the letter to the church, he always ends with the same punchline. Those who have ear to hear, listen to what the Holy Spirit says to the church. So in the end time, there will be powerful working of the Holy Spirit through his church. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 11 clearly tells us that the end time has already come upon us. So are we that church? That's a very important question. Now, one of the work that God will do through his church is that he will disclose or reveal all of God's hidden secrets through the church. Okay. That is found in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 8 through 10. That's all open to this verse. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 8 through 10. So we must understand what God wants to fulfill through his church in the end time. So Ephesians chapter 3, verse 8 through 10, it says, to me, the very least of all saints, the me here is Apostle Paul. Okay. This grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unfathomable riches of Christ and to bring to light what is the administration of the mystery which for ages has been hidden in God who created all things, so that the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known through the church. Please look at this word. God wants to bring to light. Make known. What? God's administration. This is Theos, God's. Okay. But he wants to do this, right? Bring to light, to make known of God's administration of the mystery, because nobody knew about it yet, because it was hidden in no one other than in God himself. God has disclosed it. So if it's not God, no one can find out until he opens it up again, right? But God says he's going to do this through his church. So the question is, do you have God's administration? Do you understand his redemptive history? Don't you want to be the final church in the last days through which God will perform his work? Really, thank God that our History Redemption series, right? The real title of it is not just the History Redemption series, but it is History Redemption series in the light of God's administration, right? So we are learning about God's administration. How wonderful is this? The greatest example of this God's administration of mystery that was hidden in God, I think, is the genealogy. Because no one to this day really had interest in genealogy. There was no really work done to expound God's administration in the genealogy. It's only got numbers and names. Our main text, the second period of Jesus' genealogy, the first and second, third period only takes how many verses? 16 verses. But God says there, I have hidden my administration of the mystery for ages. But now he's going to make it open to us, right? So how do we know that? I think it's the term that's found in Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. It says, Biblos Geneseos. This means generation or genealogy. But here, this word, Biblos, from this word, Bible came out, right? But it says this is the book of generation. Only 16 verses, and yet God says, this is my book, right? So this must contain this vast amount of God's administration of the mystery that we must understand. Another hint is that we can see that it's made of first and second and third period. But these first and second, third period, as Matthew chapter 1, verse 17 teaches us, God purposely structured the genealogy so that every period is fit to how many generations? Only 14. But do you know how many of years of difference each period has from each other? For example, the first period is from Abraham all the way to King David. This contains about 1,163 years. Second period is from David to the deportation to Babylon. This contains about 406 years. And from Babylon to Jesus Christ, this is about 593 years. Right? So, see, 1,063 years, 406 years, 593 years. Each period is so different, right? The amount of time is so different, and God fixed it to 14. 14 and 14 generations. This is a evidence that God has hidden this profound message that he wants to convey to us through this genealogy. To this day, no one has really found out about this. Okay. So then, what is this message that God wants to proclaim to his church and the end time so that church can actually make this administration known to all the Gentiles around the world, as Ephesians chapter 3, verse 8 through 10 says. Do we follow so far? Right? And then today, we're going to look at the second period from David all the way to the Babylon. Why does God put only 14 generations for this amount of time? In order for God to fix every period to only 14 generations, he had to take out many names, right? So we must find out who these people are and understand why their names are taken out. So if I may write down the people listed in the second period of Jesus. Okay, so let's start from here. First is David, Solomon, Rehoboam, Abijah, Asa, Jehoshaphat, Joram, Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, Hezekiah, Manasseh, Amon, Josiah. These are the 14 kings listed in the, which part? The second part of Genealogy of Jesus Christ. So you might be like, oh, these names are so hard. Why do you have to know all of these names, you might ask, right? Our senior pastor, our founding pastor, Reverend Evan Park, said this genealogy is so important, he made us memorize all of these names. Why? Because this genealogy is your genealogy. Okay? So if you open to John chapter 1, verse 12 through 13, okay, it says, anyone who receives the name of Jesus Christ receives right to become child of God, right? But this happens not by flesh or blood, or not by the will of men, but by the will of God. This means, up to this day, I'm Joanna Pei, born between my mom and father, my mom and dad, right? According to human will, according to flesh and blood. But when I receive the name Jesus Christ into my life, that moment, I am born again as a child of my Father, God. From that point on, I call this God as my Father. Okay? But who is your Father? He is the King of Kings, right? That's why it says in John chapter 1, verse 12, if you receive the name Jesus Christ, you have this right to become his child. So if I'm born again as a child of God, I am no longer just Joanna Pei under my mom and dad. I have the Pei genealogy. My last name is Pei, so my genealogy runs under name Pei. But now that I am child of God and I am born again, I have a new set of genealogy. Do you all have your genealogies? You're supposed to say amen here, right? Do you have your genealogy? Amen. We do, right? So look at this. This genealogy is so important that God wants to open up the entire New Testament with what? Genealogy. The genealogy of Jesus to proclaim that now you, my children, are in my genealogy. That's a statement right there. So this second period goes all the way down to is the final person of the genealogy, Jesus Christ. True? And if this is a descending order, if you go in ascending order, if you reach all the way to the top, who does it go all the way to? Goes to Abraham. Right? So this genealogy is Jesus' genealogy, but if you flip it around, this is also whose genealogy? Abraham's genealogy, right? So according to John chapter 1, verse 12, if I am joined to Jesus Christ to become the child of God, now I belong to whose genealogy? Jesus' genealogy, right? So in the end, what's very intriguing is that this genealogy does not start with Adam. It does not start with Noah. The very first word that opens the New Testament is the name Jesus and Abraham and David. So on the very top is Abraham. So because now you have new genealogy, your father now at the very top of your ancestor line is who? Abraham. Do you know the New Testament makes its relationship very clear throughout the whole book? For example, Galatians chapter 3, verse 29. Let's check it for ourselves. In Galatians chapter 3, verse 29, it established our relationship with Abraham because we met Jesus Christ. Okay? It says exactly this. Galatians 3, verse 29, it says, if you belong to Jesus Christ, you are Abraham's descendants. Just as the genealogy shows, right? You're Abraham's descendants, and you are an heir, now according to the promise. This is your new genealogy. But did you know that these names on the second period of genealogy, they are all kings? Your genealogy has names of kings. What does that tell you? Oh, I don't know in other cultures, but in Korean culture, if we have a king in our genealogy, you're automatically from royal family. It doesn't matter how many way up they are, right? But look at your genealogy. Our genealogy, all of these are the names of kings. Indeed, God already promised the very forefather, Abraham, in Genesis chapter 17, verse 4 through 6, God has given Abraham the covenant. And according to this covenant, God promised that through Abraham, there will be kings coming from his line. And indeed, the real kings came out. Okay? So this means that we are, by this genealogy, also kings. You're like, oh, wait a minute. I tell this to my little students all the time. If you don't know, if you don't think you're a king or prince or princesses, stop calling your God as your father. Don't call him father. You're not fit to call him father if you don't think you're a king. But if you take it further, if we are not living as real kings of God, we are not fit to call our father, our God as our father. In order for our father to be really the king of kings, we ourselves have to be those little kings first. That is the only way to glorify our Father God in our real life. Let's really be honest to ourselves. Do we know over our identity? This is so important that God began his New Testament with this genealogy to tell us we are really the children of God and that we are really the royal family to do his work, to know of his administration, to do the management on his behalf. That's the calling as Christians. It's not just we believe in Jesus, receive the forgiveness of sins. Okay, let's go to heaven. It's not just that. Our Father has greater expectations for all of us. Okay? And now in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 clearly tells us that we are the royal priest. Okay? So this is who we are. But the point is, however, in this genealogy, God took out four kings. But who got to stay and who were taken out? That's a very important question, right? So in order for us to be a good king, first of all, the fact that names were taken out means although God established them as kings, not all of them were right in God's sight, right? So God took out those kings. So that means just because we are born again as kings doesn't mean necessarily that we are good kings. We must learn from our examples to be true good kings for our Father. The missing generation is between here, Joram and Uzziah. Okay, between the Joram and Uzziah, there were four kings. They were taken out. So then who were those four kings? In Matthew chapter 1, it says Joram and Uzziah, as if they are, he's the father, he's a son, right? But if you see in 1 Chronicles chapter 3, verse 11 through 13, the actual genealogy is very different. So names are as follows. So here we have Joram. And then who do we have? Okay, and there is Ahaziah. Okay, and there's another person. And then Joash. And Amaziah. Okay, and then Uzziah. Another name for Uzziah is Azariah. Okay. Here, this person, I want to write in yellow, is named Athaliah. This person's name is not found in this genealogy, but if you see on the verse, according to 2 Kings chapter 11, verse 3, Athaliah, although she was a woman, she was a king over Israel for 6 years. Okay. So here we have Joram and Uzziah, but between how many kings? 1, 2, 3, 4 kings were taken out from the genealogy. So we must understand why. First reason, so let's make it a chart like this. Okay. Like first, oh, this board, it's Athaliah and Joash, and Amaziah. First reason is that these people were all related to this woman named Athaliah. They're related to Athaliah. Ahaziah was Athaliah's, this is the mother. Ahaziah was Athaliah's son. Joash is Athaliah's grandson. And Amaziah is the great grandson. So here, first generation, second, and this third generation, they were all completely taken out from the genealogy. So all of them were related to her. But what about her? Why is she the problem, right? Who is this woman? Now, she is actually daughter of woman name, you know very well, Jezebel. Okay. Jezebel, now all of these kings, this is very easy to remember because these are the kings of the south Judah. Like Korea was split into two, right? Between north and south. Which part is good? South, right? It's very similar. This is the part, south is where God's covenant flowed, okay? The north was, all the kings of the north were wicked. Now, Jezebel was a wife of this man named, king named Ahab. He was a king of north. I would say he's equivalent to like Kim Il-sung in North Korea, okay? Ahab was a very, very wicked king up in north. Now, Ahab married not Israelite, but this foreign woman, Jezebel. Jezebel, she's a daughter of this person named Ethbaal. From this name, you can see this is a priest of Baal. Because of her, because he married her, she brought in all the Baal idolatry in the history of Israel. She was the cause, okay? And so Jezebel and Ahab, and between the two, who was born is Athaliah. So you kind of get the point here, right? Now, all of these children were related to her, so guess what happens? Second problem is, because they are all related to Athaliah, what they learn from them is idolatry. Ahaziah, okay, Ahaziah actually walked in the house of that evil king, Ahab. And Athaliah, as we learn that she's a daughter of the daughter of Ethbaal, right? So she worshipped Baal. And Joash, although he's a part of the royal family, he worshipped Asherim. And Amaziah, he worshipped the gods of Seir, sons of Seir. Okay? Now the verses here I'd like to give to you is in 2 Chronicles chapter 22, verse 3. This is 1 Kings, I think it's like 2 Kings. 2 Kings 11, verse 18. For Athaliah, 2 Kings, verse 11, 18. Asherim is 2 Chronicles, chapter 24. For Joash is 18. We're going to actually read these verses. And then for Amaziah, 2 Chronicles chapter 25, verse 14. Okay. And because they all worshipped idol, first, they are related to who? Athaliah. And second, because of that, they all worshipped idol. And what is the consequence of that? They all died very tragically. They were all murdered. And Ahaziah was killed by Jehu. When God was executing his judgment against the house of her house in the north, in Ahab's house, this Ahaziah was also killed during that purging. Okay. And also Athaliah, she was killed by her own people during the insurrection by the gate of the horse. So killed. An insurrection. And here Joash, he was also murdered by his own servants in the bed. I'm just writing down the people who killed him. His own servants. And he was in his bed. Okay. And so is Amaziah. He was also killed in a conspiracy. By his own servants, right? So that means somebody came and stabbed their back. That's how they were all killed. So killed by Jehu. This is actually 2 Chronicles chapter 22, verses 9. And this one is 2 Kings chapter 11, verse 20. And this one is 2 Chronicles, chapter 24, verse 25. And this one, 2 Chronicles, chapter 25, verse 27. So I know this is quite complicated, right? But can you see in a glance, right, why these four kings were taken out by God, right? Because they were related to her, and because they worshipped idols, they ended up being killed. Do you think maybe the sentence is a little bit too harsh? Yes? Right? They were all murdered. They were all killed. Okay? The biggest problem with Athaliah, this woman, is that when she saw that her son, Ahaziah, was killed during the purging by Jehu, right? God executed her mom's side of the family, right? The dad's side of the family up in north. She was enraged, and she went and came into Joram, right? And between, he killed all the royal offspring that was in the palace because he was so, so enraged. But here, God has promised this covenant all the way from Abraham down to David, and all of these people are carrying this lamp of the covenant until the coming of Jesus Christ, right? And this woman, Athaliah, is trying to destroy all of those royal offspring. So that means the genealogy will be cut off right here. That's how evil she was. And she represents Satan's relentless hindrance to stop the flow of the history of redemption. Okay. So that's who she is. Let's actually read some of these verses. Let's go to, for Ahaziah, let's read 2 Chronicles chapter 22, verse 3. Okay. 2 Chronicles chapter 22, verse 3 says, he also walked in the ways of the house of Ahab, for his mother was his counselor to do wickedly, right? So as a result, what's the consequence? 2 Chronicles chapter 22, verse 9, it says, Jehu put him to death. And verse 9 below. Let's go to Athaliah. Athaliah, 2 Kings. Let's not look at Athaliah. She worshipped house of Baal and she was killed in the insurrection. Let's go to Joash. 2 Chronicles chapter 24, verse 18. If you flip a few pages back. 2 Chronicles chapter 24, verse 18. Okay. Look at this. And they abandoned the house of the Lord. Right? They abandoned the house of the Lord, the God of their fathers, and served the Asherim and the idols. So wrath came upon Judah and Jerusalem for this their guilt. Okay. The wrath came upon not on the individual. The wrath came upon the entire Jerusalem. Depending on how king serves God, the nation can either be prosperous or a nation can be in complete devastation, depending on how the king serves God. We started out saying that we are all kings of God, right? According to 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. How well are you serving your God? Our elder Jabez prayed for this month of patriotism, right? Remembering all the martyrs, all the leaders who have sacrificed their lives to protect this nation. But do you know the quality of your life of faith has a direct outcome of the welfare of your own countries? That's how important every one of you are in God's sight. Okay? And let's also look at, just if you go down a few verses, since we are already there, 2 Chronicles chapter 24, verse 25. And when they had departed from him, for they left him very sick, his own servants conspired against him and murdered him on his bed. So he died. Right? This is the outcome of being a wicked king. Let's also go to Amaziah. 2 Chronicles chapter 25, verse 14 says how he brought the gods of the sons of Seir, but let's actually read verse 27. Verse 27 says, and from the time that Amaziah turned away from following the Lord, they conspired against him in Jerusalem. God makes it clear what point of time the conspiracy began. The conspiracy against the king began the very moment he walked away from God. Satan knows exactly who he wants to attack, right? He knows if he attacks the king, whole nation will go down. But you, God says, are the kings in this time, right? That's why our shoulders are very heavy. That's why we have to learn this administration of God. Do this hard studies, right, about the Bible. The things that even theologians or any pastor or scholars do not know, you are sitting here studying because you are truly the kings of God who must rule over this world with his heart. So the moment we walk away from God, the consequences is just really devastating. We pray for North Korea, but I think we really, really should be praying for ourselves. If we walk away from God, if our faith is not a faith of good quality to God, then North Korea stands right there, lurking us with all their threats, right? Not only for President Park Geun-hye or political leaders we should pray for, but we should really, really make sure we are true kings who are working to serve our countries, right? That is calling of God. That is understanding the identity. despite Satan's relentless hindrance, right, to break off the covenant. These people like ganged up together, right, to break off this lineage of the covenant. But despite this, from Satan's side, whose name emerged, this name, Athaliah, right? There's another name that emerges to actually block this attack from Satan. Another woman's name, actually. It is Jehoshabiat. When Athaliah came and killed all the royal offspring, this woman named Jehoshabiat, she saved one royal offspring. Okay, she's sister of Ahaziah. Okay, and she saved Joash. For 6 years, she hid him. Okay, their names are very interesting. Athaliah means afflicted by God. Okay, as the name indicates, you can see there's big warfare between Athaliah and God, right? But the name Jehoshabiat, okay, Shab means oath, means Jehovah, right? It means the covenant of the Lord. So what stops or blocks Satan's relentless attack against the flow of the covenantal generation? The only thing that's really protecting this line is what? The covenant itself. The covenant itself is protecting us, not because we are good kings, not because there were perfect kings. There are some bad kings there too, right? But every time these kings go bad, God will intervene and say, remember my covenant. For the sake of the covenant that I made with Abraham and David, I will let you live. What's important here? The covenant of the Lord. Then since we are the kings, do you have the covenant? Do you tangibly feel the covenant burning in your heart? What is the covenant that God gave to them? Just the word, the covenant? The kings were actually, it's very interesting. Jehoshabiat means, oh, let me give you the verse for her. Jehoshabiat. It's 2 Chronicles chapter 22, verse 10 and 11. 2 Chronicles chapter 22, verse 10 and 11 talks about how Athaliah tried to destroy all the royal offsprings, and Jehoshabiat came and protected the royal, one royal offspring. Okay. But now, this covenant, the name Jehoshabiat tells us that covenant is the only thing that's protecting this lineage. It's very important that we stay in this covenant because it is to Abraham God gave the covenant, and only the people by promise are true children of God. So if you don't have the covenant, means you're a legitimate child, right? So do we have the covenant? What's the covenant? The covenant is the lamp. The lamp. Let's all look at Psalm 132, verse 17. God said, there will always be a lamp, okay, in the house of David. Psalm 132, verse 17. Okay, let's read together. Psalm 132, verse 17. Okay, ready, begin. There I will cause the horn of David to spring forth. I have prepared a lamp for mine anointed. Okay. So, you see, there are three kings with whom God reconfirms his covenant that he gave to the very first king, David. The people are here, the Rehoboam, Abijah, and this Joram at the verge of great danger, right, of the lineage being cut off. For these three people, God reconfirmed the covenant of the lamp. Okay? You will get the feel of what God's trying to say when you read the verse. Actually, let's go to 1 Kings chapter 11, verse 36. 1 Kings chapter 11, verse 36. For Rehoboam. 1 Kings chapter 11, verse 36. The three people are Rehoboam, Abijah, and Joram. Okay. And 1 Kings chapter 11, verse 36 says, "But to his son I will give one tribe, that my servant David may have a lamp always before me in Jerusalem." Right? So what is God thinking of? He's making sure there is a lamp always in Jerusalem. The lamp. Why would God use lamp? Let's think about this, okay? And then if you see, in 1 Kings chapter 15, verse 4, a few chapters behind, 1 Kings chapter 15, verse 4. Let's read together. 1 Kings chapter 15, verse 4. Okay, ready, begin. "But for David's sake, the Lord his God gave him a lamp in Jerusalem to raise up his son after him and to establish Jerusalem." Again, lamp, okay? These people were not good kings. That means the covenant is in danger, right? The lineage can cut off if these are bad kings. So every time the kings are kind of getting weak and kind of get wishy-washy, right? God makes sure, "I have made the covenant of lamp with David." And also lastly, 2 Kings chapter 8, verse 19, this is for Joram. The one we just read is for Abijah. And for Joram, when Athaliah was all at her madness, 2 Kings chapter 8, verse 19. Okay? 2 Kings chapter 8, verse 19. Okay, it says, ready, begin. "However, the Lord was not willing to destroy Judah for the sake of David his servant, since he had promised him to give a lamp to him through his sons always." Right? So what is this? God is trying to make sure there is always a lamp among the sons of David until Jesus Christ comes, right? Then what is this lamp? Lamp, a golden lampstand in the temple. Each king is a lamp of God. Every king. True king must be able to shine light in darkness. Because that's what our king did for us. If you see in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, the verse that tells us we are the royal priest, it says, "We must proclaim his excellencies of bringing us out of darkness into his marvelous light." Do you have that light? What is a lamp? The word of God is a lamp. Okay? The word of God is a lamp upon our feet. And that is in Psalm 119, verse 105. Psalm 119, verse 105, right? And also in Proverbs chapter 6, verse 23. Proverbs chapter 6, verse 23 says, "The commandment of God is a lamp upon our feet." Okay? So you see, when we have this word in us, then God says, "Now you are my lamp." Do you see? When we have the word in us, God says, "Now you are my lamp. For the spirit of a man is God's lamp." It says, Proverbs chapter 20, verse 27. Let's us actually read this together. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 27. Okay, ready, begin. If I don't read it, okay, let's read together. Ready, begin.
"The spirit of man is the lamp of the Lord, searching all the innermost parts of his being."
Yes, the spirit of a man is the lamp of the Lord. So look at this. The word of God is not supposed to be float around in the air. The word of God is supposed to be in your heart. Okay? When you receive the word of God, then you become true king because you are now the lamp of our mighty God. That's what the definition of king is. Okay? But any time that they try to walk away from the word of God, God comes back and makes sure you are truly my lamp. There will always be a lamp before me in Jerusalem, God says. I believe we are the light in this generation. We are very, very special people. And you have a mighty mission ahead of you to shine the light. Okay? If you go to Luke chapter 11, verse 33, that we are the lamp in the end time. Luke chapter 11, verse 3 says, no one, after lighting a lamp, puts it away in a cellar or under a basket. But put it on where? On the lampstand. That's in Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 1, verse 20, it says, the seven lampstands are the church of God. Right? We are supposed to shine the light in the darkness. Right? Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. We have to proclaim this marvelous light that God has put us into. Now, if you're not in the marvelous light, then you have to actually double check where you are right now. If you're in the darkness, then you will not be able to shine the light. If you're associated with these idols, as we can see right here, God is making his point very clear. If you're a king, and if you associate with the idols, then you're down, along with your nation. Brothers and sisters, now is the time to drop every idol that we have in our lives. Because our identity has been proclaimed. We are the true children of God. We are the kings to shine light in the darkness. I pray that we will help one another in prayer. If there's anything that we love more than God himself, let us encourage and strengthen one another through prayer to drop every form of idol in our lives. Only then you can actually put up on high and shine the light for all the world. Okay? So let's read 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. Okay, ready, begin. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Okay? We must get rid of all idols. God says, do not love this world. Everything in this world does not come from Father. Let's be really honest. Let's look at our life of faith. Do we really love God the most? Or do we love other things? It's good to love, but just not more than you love God. We have to set the priorities straight. Let's all turn to 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 through 17. We come this far, right? We came very, very far. We've been set apart from a lot of Christian life, too, by really devoting our lives and spending so much time at church, spending so much time studying the word, right? Let us now just drop anything that holds us back from God so we can truly rise high as real kings in this world, right? 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 through 17. Let us read together. Ready, begin. Do not love the world nor the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the boastful pride of life is not from the Father, but is from the world. The world is passing away, and also its lusts. But the one who does the will of God lives forever. I pray that Shiloh will truly be the lampstand of God to shine the light to all the world. And therefore, we are the ones to fulfill, okay, this calling that he has for us. Let us be the one to really fulfill the will of God for this generation. Don't you think our Father's been waiting enough? Ever since he created man and blessed them in Genesis chapter 1, verse 28, please, you have my image and likeness. Go and conquer and subdue and rule all the world, the creation that I made. Don't you think our Father has waited enough for us to now rise as his kings, to truly be the conquerors? But again, the message is clear. We can't do it unless we drop the every form of the idols. Amen? Okay, let's pray. Our living Father God, we thank you so much for awakening us to our true identity. Father, we desire to become your true little kings. Help us to fight against the sinful world and overcome ourselves, overcome the sins, and overcome this world. Help us to let go of all the idols which are separating us from you. Help us to truly cherish the word that you have given us with all your life. Let us keep those precious words in our hearts. Let no idols enter in our lives or our heart, so we can truly become your kings to shine the marvelous light against the entire world. Father, help us. We want to be true kings. We don't want to be wicked kings. We don't want to be just somebody. We don't want this worship service to be something that happens every Lord's Day, like some kind of a habit. Father, help us to truly meet you through this worship service on this blessed Lord's Day, which you have designated for us to come and meet you. Help us to meet you, Father, so that we can be connected back to the origin of your image and likeness, back to the fountain of eternal life of the Most High, so we can receive all the strength, we can receive all the power and majesty, so we can just get rid of all the idols, tear down all the idols and the worships, and truly love you with all of heart and mind and soul. Help us to be true kings so that we can truly bring this nation into the prosperity to bring the glory for the word of redemptive history in the end. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's give our Father glory.
Thank you. We were greatly blessed by the message. Let's sing hymn number 259.
Thank you. Let's pray. Thank you, Father. Thank you for giving your manna to eat us that our fathers had never known and our fathers had wanted eagerly. Only by your grace we, O Shiloh, gather here together like family. We before you, we listen, we receive your word, Father. Father, make us remember and make us know your word and your grace so that we can spread the word of your life. It's time to offering now. Please use this offering to enlarge your kingdom and spread the redemptive history series. And remember the hands who serve you, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Jesus, so great, gently closing
Thank you very much. We've received many tithes, thank offerings, and membership dues today. We have some newcomers. When I call out your name, please stand to be recognized. Invited by Chloe Song, we have Park Ji-hae. Also, we have Park Seo-mi. Invited by Kim Myung-hae, we have Kim Myung-eun. And from Los Angeles, we have Jessica Lim visiting us today. Thank you so much for coming. We would like to welcome you properly with song. Or do we? Thank you so much for visiting Shiloh, just as the word that was proclaimed today. Shiloh, by holding on to the word of redemptive history, holds on to the light of the covenant. Amen? Amen? Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for the blessed word that you have given to us, the holy manna, Father God, that is spiritual food. We have truly seen how by holding on to your word and its light, that we are to cast away all idols away from our lives. I pray, Father God, that your grace will be with us so that we will continue to burn the lamp of the covenant so that we will truly be able to fulfill your will that is in redemptive history. Father God, thank you so much for the offerings that we have received. This is just a small portion giving back to you what you have so greatly blessed us with. May this offering, Father God, be used to further expand your kingdom and further proclaim your word of redemptive history. And in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. If you'll please turn to your bulletin for the announcements. We have a History of Redemption seminar coming in Hawaii this June 10th and 11th. Please keep that in your prayers and also for those who are traveling. Also, please keep your prayers for Pastor Andrew, who is on a missions trip to our New York branch church. Pray that God's protection and grace will be with him as he presides over the New York church for about a month duration and also for his safe return to Shiloh. Also, Elder Jabez, that's me, will be... I guess I'll be going to Indonesia for 3 weeks. please keep me in your prayers. Thank you very much. Elder and Elders Hemming will also be traveling over the next month. Please keep them in your prayers. Now that it's the summer, there's a lot of people who will be traveling overseas, whether for business or vacation or mission trips. If you have responsibilities in Shiloh, please let our worship leaders know. So that they don't accidentally put you in some sort of service and we find out the day of that you're not able to do so. Please continue to pray for our brother Brian and Aaron Pan's daughter Rachel. She recently had a major surgery due to her scoliosis. By Father's grace, that surgery went well, but please keep her in your prayers so that she'll continue to make a full and complete recovery. Also pray for Father's healing hand on our sister Park Young-soo. Her mother is still recovering from her surgery, so please keep her in your prayers as well. Please join us also on Wednesday night after service so that we may intercede for each other in prayer and also pray for the work of redemptive history. Also, continuing in prayer, every evening at 10 p.m. as one body of Shiloh, we would like to pray. So whether you're at home or at work, please keep that time in mind. And our Bible reading this week is Job chapter 14 through Job chapter 37. This is not in the bulletin, but all praise team members, instrumental, whoever is here, after service, please stay behind. We're going to have a meeting for about 10 minutes. This is for the praise team. And also, one other unlisted announcement. Our dear sister, Deborah Koh, is getting restationed. Where are you going again? Kansas. Very exciting. So please keep her in your prayers. In appreciation for all that she's done for Shiloh and being a good sister to us in the Lord, we have prepared a gift for her. Deborah, don't be shy. Please come up. Let's give her a hand. So she is one of the many brave individuals serving in the military. So this being the month to commemorate patriotism, let's definitely keep our brave soldiers, sailors, Marines, and airmen in our prayers. Are there any other announcements? Okay, let's please rise, sing hymn number 6, and we'll close with the Lord's Prayer. Temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.